talk of a public transport system for Sandhurst and the neighbouring borough of Eagle Hawk began in the early 1880s. The consolidation of the mining industry after the booming but erratic days of the 70s had meant a considerable increase in the regular workforce, and as the city developed, it was apparent that a cheap method of moving numbers of people from place to place was needed. There was already a large cab fleet, but this was not a cheap means of transport, and for most working people, walking was the only way. The first permanent electric tramway system in the world was installed in 1881 from Lichterfeld Ost to Berlin's Anhalt station. There had been crude pioneer tramways in America, but the German system invented by Dr. Werner Siemens and originally exhibited at the Berlin Exhibition in 1879 was the first orthodox electric motor-driven system. Progressive Sandhurst began to consider the possibilities of such a system only a few years later. In May 1887, the councils of Sandhurst and Eagle Hawk held their first tramway conference to discuss the possibility of linking the two centres. Several ideas were discussed at this time. Horse trams, cable trams, an overhead wire electric system, battery trams, and even the conversion of horse cabs to horse-drawn trams. The overhead wire system was rejected on the grounds that it would spoil the landscape, and little was heard of most of the other ideas. The public was involved. Some people were for and some against the installation of a tramway system, and there were petitions and considerable debate about the proposed routes. One of the arguments against trams was that the town's money would be going to Melbourne business interests and taking work away from the local cabbies. The cab industry was a large one, with approximately 150 cabs using 220 horses, and the interests of not only the cabbies were at stake. Many people serviced the industry, including coach builders, farriers and grain merchants, and it was estimated that more than $20,000 was spent each year on feeding and shoeing the horses for the cab fleet. When a definite proposal to run a horse train, or in fact a horse-drawn cab on rails, was put forward, there was a public outcry which condemned the scheme on a number of grounds, including the route, the laying of rails on roadways, and the cruelty involved in horses pulling heavy trams over long distances. In any event, the scheme was abandoned, and little happened until the tramway conference called for tenders towards the end of 1887. This resulted in three firm proposals. A double-track cable tramway from the Sandhurst Railway Station to the Eagle Hawk Town Hall, supplemented by a single-track horse tramway from Golden Square to Lake Waroona, later to be extended to Kangaroo Flat and White Hills, by Wolf Mendel of Melbourne. A horse tramway from Sandhurst Railway Station to Eagle Hawk by Thompson Moore and Company of Ballarat, and a horse tramway from Sandhurst to Eagle Hawk and White Hills, which was the pattern system of the Crusoe Works. As it happened, none of these was accepted, and the tramway conference began to show a preference for the battery trams. In April 1888, the translation of details of M. Julien's French battery system was tabled at a tramway conference by W. Masters. Subsequently, the only tender received was from the Melbourne Civil and Electrical Engineers, Booth, Elson and Company, who offered to operate a battery tram car system between Sandhurst and Eagle Hawk for a 30-year period. The contract included plans for a second line from Kangaroo Flat to White Hills. The councils were evidently impressed with the scheme, and on 9th October 1888, the Sandhurst and Eagle Hawk Tramway Company came into being. Despite the optimism and enthusiasm shown at the beginning of the project, the battery tramway was never to prosper. Mr. Elson went to England to buy the necessary trams and machinery and returned in May 1889, having ordered six cars and associated equipment. He had also tested one car himself on steep grades and with heavy loads. but there were delays at home and abroad with confusion over the allocation of money for works by the local councils and dockyard strikes in London. When the first car did arrive in October, the powerhouse in Mollison Street was not completed, so the initial test run was horse-drawn rather than battery-powered. The car was hauled by horses from the depot to Eagle Hawk and back to test the tracks. When the powerhouse was completed and the tram cars and equipment all assembled, the first true test was carried out on 10th April 1890 with poor results, which augured badly for the future. Hardly had the tram left the depot when a derailment occurred, and to make matters worse, when on the tracks again, there was such severe arcing from the motors that there was danger of fire. 2 weeks later, the trial was repeated with slightly better results, although the tram only travelled on the level track outside the depot. By mid-June, all 8 cars ordered, which had been increased from 6, had arrived and were assembled. A half-hourly service was commenced along part of the proposed route on 14th June, and the service to Eagle Hawk was eventually achieved in late July. But the journey took longer than planned. Although the service operated on a daily basis, it was always an unsatisfactory business. Derailments and minor accidents were the rule rather than the exception, and there were frequent severe electrical and mechanical breakdowns. In addition to these problems, it appeared as though Mr. Elson's test drives had been inadequate, as the heavy trams were underpowered for the steep hills between Sandhurst and Eagle Hawk. It was quite common for the overtaxed batteries to give out on the return journey, with the result that horses would have to be sent out to tow the cars back to the depot. The passengers, unhappy at being stranded far from their destination, would have to walk or find alternative transport, much to the delight of the waiting cabbies who hovered around the stranded monsters like vultures around a wounded elephant. The system limped on for 13 weeks without any improvement in its service or its public image, and on 23rd September 1890, the battery trams were removed from the tracks. Unable to solve the problem of public transport for the city, the company went into voluntary liquidation, and its assets were bought by the newly formed Bendigo Tramways Company Limited. With the dismal failure of the battery trams, Bendigo was once again without public transport, and although the councils were eager to have a tramway system, they were still firmly against the overhead wire system. The Bendigo Tramways Company suggested steam trams as an alternative, and when this was agreed upon, 5 steam tram motors were ordered from the United States of America. The motors were built by the Baldwin Locomotive Works, and engineers from the company came to Bendigo to supervise their assembly. A local firm, the Bendigo Rolling Stock Company, rebuilt the old battery trams, which were to be pulled behind the steam motors as trailers. The rebuilding consisted of removing the heavy banks of batteries, extending the end platforms, and fitting bolsters and bogies. On 1st February 1892, almost 18 months after the last disastrous days of the battery tramway, the Bendigo Tramways Company put its first 5 steam motors and trailers into service. The steam trams, with their compact boilers, squat chimneys and accompanying trailers, were quite spectacular, and the people of Bendigo took them to their hearts. Their hissing engines were a success, and their relative safety and reliability made them immediately popular with the travelling public. There were, however, complaints from householders along the route about sparks and smut from the motors, which sometimes caused fires in overgrown gardens and wreaked havoc on the lines of snowy washing. But the advantages far outweighed the disadvantages, and within a week the company had put in an order for 2 extra motors, later increased to 3, and 3 trailers. This extra rolling stock was supplied locally. The trailers again converted from battery trams by the Bendigo Rolling Stock Company, and the motors built in Ballarat by the Phoenix Foundry. The motors were larger than the original ones, with the idea that they would be able to haul not 1, but 2 trailers. These large motors proved to be a success and indeed sometimes pulled two large trailers and a small one as well. The system was well patronised and in the first 5 months more than 250,000 passengers were carried between Bendigo and Eagle Hawk over a distance of nearly 70,000 kilometres. Despite the popularity of the steam trams, the company was not without its difficulties. The planned extension of the service to include a route from Kangaroo Flat to White Hills was never to be built due to the economic depression of the 1890s. 1892 saw the tramway's first industrial dispute, with six drivers and four conductors striking on the grounds that the motors were unsafe. The motors were tested by a locomotive superintendent from the railways and declared safe. The case went to an independent arbitrator who decided in favour of the company, and the men were all sacked. The cabbies loathed the steaming monsters and complained constantly that the belching smoke and sparks cascading from the chimneys upset their horses. There was also trouble with the railways. In 1894, the special freight rate for steaming coke was stopped, thus increasing expenses. During the ensuing legal wrangles, coal and wood were tried without success. The Bendigo Gas Company was unable to supply the amount of coke required, so it had to be freighted in. Finally, the company won its case against the Victorian Railways, and settlement of $494 was paid. But feelings were strained, and within a year, the railways were complaining about the trams running on the railway reserve outside the station. The tramway was ordered to remove the tracks and resurface the road within 7 days. The Bendigo City Council, however, supported the Bendigo Tramways Company, and it was pointed out that the trams provided an efficient service for rail passengers arriving and departing from the station. But the railway's attitude prevailed, and eventually the short track from Mitchell Street to the station was removed. There was dissatisfaction too with the slow service to Eagle Hawk, and many passengers disliked waiting 20 minutes between trams. The company's rolling stock was inadequate to meet the demands made on it during peak periods, holidays and on special occasions such as football matches and fair days. The economic depression of the 1890s affected Bendigo less than many other centres not backed by its massive gold industry. But the company felt the effects in decreased passenger numbers. However, despite low returns to the shareholders, it persisted with its plan for the duplication of the Eagle Hawk line and the acquisition of new rolling stock. Towards the end of the decade, the size of the trailer fleet had been doubled to 16. Fares ranged from threepence to sixpence with a penny, halfpenny prepaid ticket. The company employed about 50 people, drivers and conductors, wore no special uniform, although they were distinguished by the company's cap and badge. The steam motors and trailers of the Bendigo Tramways Company carried many hundreds of thousands of passengers over the Bendigo to Eagle Hawk route in the 1890s, and the hissing, steaming motors with their showers of sparks were a colourful part of the city during the decade. But the company was unable to meet its commitments to extend the service or to keep the tracks in good repair, let alone run at a profit, and the shareholders could not hang on forever. The tramway was put up for sale in 1896-7, but as there were no offers, the company decided it was best to keep the service running as it would be more saleable as a going concern. The steam tram disposal records are rather scant, and of the 8 locos owned by the Bendigo Tramways Company Limited, only 3 were officially recorded, and these details were recorded by the new owners. 2 of the trams were sold to David Mitchell's limestone quarry in Lilydale, Victoria, while another was sold to the Marawar Tramway in Tasmania. Let's begin by examining the tale of the first sale. Cave Hill Limestone Quarry, Lilydale, was a limestone quarry and processing plant established in 1878 by David Mitchell. Mitchell also established a farm at the site, which operated from the 1880s to 1921. Mitchell was a Scottish-born building contractor who became a prominent figure in Victorian society and was the father of Dame Nellie Melba. Mitchell's building projects included Scott's Church and the Royal Exhibition Building. A successful entrepreneur, he was involved in many business ventures, including the highly successful Cave Hill Limestone Quarry. During the 19th century, the production of lime mortars and plasters were integral to construction. Lime production in Victoria started on a small scale in the 1830s, concentrated in coastal locations, notably Geelong. The Cave Hill Limestone Quarry represents the second stage of the lime industry in Victoria, characterised by access to rail transport and management by larger companies. David Mitchell invested in infrastructure such as steam-powered cranes, a network of tram lines to transport timber, and a battery of pot kilns that enabled round-the-clock lime burning despite the limitations of the intermittent technology. The Cave Hill estate also supported a large-scale farming operation. By 1894, dairy and meat processing factories were established at the site. The tramway was standard gauge and was gradually extended and ran from the works along Swansea and York Roads and then south along the Olinda Creek to near the Sylvan Reservoir. The distance was about 10 kilometres. Along the line was a bridge across the Olinda Creek and 2 road crossings where gates were erected. Bendigo Tramways ceased using steam engines in 1903. David Mitchell bought 2 of their locomotives that year. Number 2, built by Baldwin of Philadelphia, USA, and number 7, built by the Phoenix Foundry of Ballarat. The locos arrived at Cave Hill sometime during 1903 and were soon put to work. In 1916, following Mitchell's death, the ownership of Cave Hill passed to the David Mitchell Estate Trust. During the 1920s, the plant and equipment continued to be remodeled and mechanised, and Cave Hill Limestone Quarry became one of the leading industrial plants in Australia. It was noted in 1998, the remains of the 2 Bendigo Tramway steam locos were still in existence, though partly buried and in a poor state of decay. The locomotive to become known as Spider, in its service on the Marawar Tramway in Tasmania, was originally a small Baldwin-built steam tram constructed in 1890 for usage on the 4-foot 8.5-inch gauge in Bendigo, Victoria. In 1911, the Marawar Tramway Company purchased the locomotive for the Marawar Tramway, and when the loco had to be re-gauged from 4-foot 8.5 to 3-foot 6 inches, the width of the firebox didn't allow the frames to be brought in sufficiently to make room for wheel flanges of normal width, so the latter were only 1/4 inch wide. When the engine first entered service, it was easily distinguishable by the presence of an open-sided roof running the full length of the locomotive. On the 5th of February 1913, the loco hauled the first official load on the Marawar Tramway. On that day, the train set out from the 17 mile, where it loaded 9.5 tons of cheese, 2 tons of wool, and hides from the Marawar area. From there, the train went on towards Smithton. When Spider passed into ownership of the Public Works Department in 1914, the locomotive was the only one that the PWD owned at the time and was considered by Mr. Ford, manager of the tramway, as our number one engine, apparently meaning it in the numerical sense and the qualitative sense of which Spider was considered the best engine the PWD owned. Spider survived to be the last of the PWD's original four locomotives remaining at Smithton, until on 4th April 1949, Spider was purchased by the Britton Brothers for usage on their logging tramway at Britton Swamp in Tasmania, which was a branch of the Marrawah Tramway. Spider was moved on the back of a truck to Britton Swamp because by that time, most of the tramway up to where the Britton's tramway branched off was torn up. Spider was put into service hauling loads of timber to the mill, assisting the ageing Marshall traction engine loco the Britons already owned, although it was not very successful, but even so it worked up until 1954, when the Britons obtained their diesel number one, and Spider was abandoned beside the track at the Britton Brothers Electric Mill. The locomotive's underframe and wheels were later separated from the locomotive and used as a log bogie on the tramway, and the boiler and cab left until 1973, when the boiler was removed and fitted to the frames and wheels of a six-wheeler to create a display locomotive at the Marrawah Hall, which was then dumped in the Marrawah Tip in 1984. The steam era, which had operated with mixed results for almost a decade, was wound up in the early years of the new century. In 1899, an English company, the British Insulated Wire Company, bought out the struggling Bendigo Tramways Company, and a new company was incorporated as the Electric Supply Company of Victoria. Although it was to be more than 4 years before the first electric trams were to run, the decision to introduce an overhead wire system heralded a new era in public transport for the city. The new company had a grand scheme which included the purchase of the Bendigo Tramways Company, a 30-year franchise to install and operate electric trams using the overhead wire system, and an extensive network of tracks linking the city of Bendigo with Golden Square, Kangaroo Flat, Quarry Hill, White Hills and Eagle Hawk. Although the company had bought the old Mollison Street premises, used by the Bendigo Tramways Company during the days of steam, they were considered inadequate for the new enterprise and land was bought opposite Arnold Street, now Tramways Avenue. Building started in 1901 and a generating plant, substation, workshop, stores, a tram depot and offices were constructed. The building, with its massive red brick walls, steel columns and roof trusses, is still in use today. Incidentally, this was the first time in Victoria that steel truss construction had been used outside the Melbourne metropolitan area. The original rather grandiose scheme was somewhat modified, with the result that when the first trams ran in 1903, there was a single track from Bendigo to Eagle Hawk with seven passing loops connecting a double track section of View and Barnard Streets, Bendigo to the double track in High Street Eagle Hawk. Sometime later, the double tracks were extended up Mitchell Street to the railway station with a single track out to Quarry Hill, with two passing loops and a single track with passing loops from Golden Square through to Lake Waroona, except for the double track section in Pall Mall and Macrae Street. A new electric tram was given a trial run in Pall Mall on 8th April 1903. Two evenings later, two trams operated from Arnold Street. Reporting the occasion, the Bendigo Advertiser of 11th April 1903 noted, "A couple of new electric cars were brought out and plied to and fro in the Mall. Crowds lined the streets and the company carried passengers, a small charge being made. The cars ran satisfactorily and travelled at a good speed. They did not go beyond the Alexander Fountain in Charing Cross." The residents of Eagle Hawk did not have to wait for long. On 11th of April, the first tram went to the borough and back, and although a few problems with the rails were reported, a continuous service was established on the 15th of April. The trams were said to make the journey well, and if they occasionally left the rails at the points, in most cases the delay was only momentary. The system was officially opened on 21st April 1903, and again the Bendigo Advertiser reports, "Today we'll witness the inauguration of the first tramway service to run in Victoria, and Bendigo enjoys the distinction of being the pioneer city of electric street traction." With the Eagle Hawk to Bendigo line in full swing, there was a 10-minute service during part of the morning, in the middle of the day and in the early evening, and a 15-minute service during periods of lesser demand. And so began the service which was to provide cheap and reliable public transport for the people of Bendigo for 18 hours a day, 7 days a week, for the next 69 years. Although there were a few major problems with the new electric service, there were small ones which gave rise to some consternation. The fascination of this novel mode of transport led the schoolboys of the day to engage in all sorts of acrobatic exploits which caused alarm and fear that accidents may occur. Again from the Bendigo Advertiser, "Yesterday, many passengers were greatly alarmed at the daring manner in which the boys raced in front of the cars or crossed the rails in sportive fashion, within a few yards of them. The drivers in many cases experienced an anxious time, and it is apparent the prompt steps should be taken to put an end to the foolishness, otherwise an accident is only a matter of time." There were also complaints that the trams interfered with alarm systems and telephone services. Evidently, the problem stemmed from magnetisation cores in some appliances and induction from the tramways. But in the main, the trams were welcomed enthusiastically by the general public and soon became very much part of the daily life of Bendigo. The services were timed to suit special occasions. On Sundays, the trams were scheduled to coincide with the major church services, and on Friday and Saturday evenings, they were packed with theatre-goers and the last trams out took the theatre crowds home. Over the years, the tramway was to provide mass transport for all Bendigo's special occasions, and the trams were often gaily decorated for fairs, centenaries and street processions. Special trams were put on to take people to the cemetery on Mother's Day, spectators to the annual Henley on Lake Waroona, and to the special service held on Coffin Reserve for Hospital Sunday. The double-decker trailer cars, originally Ballarat horse trams, with their open upper decks and frivolous canvas tops, were particularly popular for summer outings. Many years after the first electric trams ran in Bendigo, the Bendigo Trust came upon the body of former Esco car number 8 in 1970. Found at White Hills, a suburb of Bendigo, the tram had been used as a chicken coop and was in wonderful condition. The tram was moved back to Bendigo in 1971 and remained at the Central Deborah Gold Mine for many years. It was eventually restored and was launched on 9th December 2012. Other former Esco cars were discovered as well, these being numbers 5, 6 and 7. Numbers 5 and 6 became patterns for the restoration of number 8. Number 5 no longer exists, but a shortened version of number 6 is displayed at the Central Deborah Gold Mine. Number 7, which was found at a house in Waroona Avenue, was retained in the form it was found and unchanged from the time it was sold in 1930. This tram is displayed at the tram depot and is the subject of the following report.
Number 7. Yeah, those floorboards will be a bit weak, mate.
Yeah. It says on there, look both ways before getting off.
Oh, okay.
But it says the same thing over there on all of them. And I've tried to work out what it says on here.
Oh, yeah.
But then I realised they did the one at the gold mine, number 6. They actually rubbed number 8's bulkhead back to get the lettering, so they'll use that for number 8.
Look at the lettering up there. Yeah, to carry 20 on this platform.
Yeah.
Well, that'd be... So what? You'd have... Oh, you'd what? 5, 10, and
plus
10 standing.
10 standing. Oh, jeez.
Yeah, super. But number 8 now, I'd be able to handle it because it's so strong.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
No? But these things were so... Look at the sag on it.
Mm.
You can even see it here, mate. Look at the freaking end on it.
Yeah.
You can see how low it is at the front. Well, the end, I mean.
And that's even without the... I mean, I know it hasn't got the supports under it from the truck, but...
Yeah.
That's without passengers or anything like that.
See, those seats are original, the frames and that.
Yeah, that's right.
I thought they might have used these on number 8, actually. Oh, actually, number 8's probably... The parts they've used are from the original number 8.
Yeah, probably.
Oh, hang on. Would they be?
I don't know that 8 came with its seats.
No, because 8 was converted. For one man
yeah,
off.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, so
they would have ripped these seats out.
Might be from number 6.
Yeah, possibly, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, that's right. There you go. They took one of the seats out of number 6 because they've shortened 6. The apron's here.
Mm.
So they've taken 2 seats out of number 6, so they'll have used those as patterns.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And they'd have used the original ones first. Yeah. So this will go on number 8, all this stuff.
This is great. This was the best find of the lot, 7.
Oh, yeah.
I went with Gary. Gary and I went on our... raid on the morning we found it.
Yep.
And was down there on Warrinor Avenue. And we he came round to my place. Well, it was a Sunday morning about 6 o'clock, 5 o'clock even. Rode our bikes down. Gary had his camera and we went crept in through all the bush and all that stuff next to this house, right? And he's going, this is it. But see, this has all been scraped back.
Yeah.
Because when we first saw it, it had a 7 on the side.
Yeah, it's on the other side.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, I don't know why one side's got the number and the other side hasn't.
Yeah. So that's the original.
That's why I've wondered and I've said to them too, you see all these photos back in 1903 or whatever, how do we know that they didn't have a number on the other side? They're all just strategically placed.
Yeah.
They've got the artwork on one side. But this will all get... The Cinerama actually has all the...
Oh, they've already done this,
haven't
they?
Because they've done it for number 6. The gold one. It's got all the...
So number 6 has got that?
Yeah, all they need to do is just print it off and come in here and stick it on.
Mm, it's magic, isn't it?
Yeah.
But to see the original...
Oh, yeah. I prefer hand-painted stuff, obviously. Like, look at 19, it's lasted for ages.
Yeah.
But to know that if anything comes off, somebody, you know, gets in a crash or something like that, they can just print it off, come and stick it back on again.
Yeah.
Done.
Yep. Amazing stuff, mate. Oh, look at the red.
Yeah, I think that was a later thing, because this was used as part of the house or whatever they did with it.
Oh, you reckon the owners painted that?
Yeah.
Okay. Look, there's the original glass.
Yeah, it's a bit different to the one in 8, but 8's is still not.
Yeah, it's pretty similar.
Yeah.
They've done a good job in trying to match it. You know, I mean, some of them are a little bit beyond help, aren't they?
I'm hoping they've got the strap hangers, the little...
Oh, for the bell.
Yeah, they're actually not brass. They're brass, but they're chrome-plated.
Oh, yeah.
This is a Victorian-era tram.
Yeah.
And chrome was big back then. But it's the Edwardian trams, like 1925 and all, that had brass.
Oh, so that's... They must have had a bit of... like a pole through there, did they?
Yeah.
And then you had the straps hanging off the pole.
That's how it's got the pole.
Oh, okay. Yeah, there it is. Yeah. Oh, nice. So did they have a conductor's belt or not?
Yeah, you can see down this end where the bell...
Where the cord went.
See where the bell is, or was, up there.
Oh, is that
there? And
the
cord goes through the middle. There's a hole on the bulkhead that goes straight through.
Oh, right.
And it just sort of hangs in the middle of the saloon. So the conductor has to ring the bell from either right at the entrance or in the saloon.
So the passengers weren't allowed to use it?
No, it was a conductor's responsibility.
So if a passenger wanted to get off, the conductor will just pull it back.
Or if you're in the saloon, I suppose you could.
So that's a little bit like the cable cars in San Francisco.
Pretty much.
Gee. I've never noticed every that, mate.
We do eight. We probably try and do something where make it a little bit more conventional like the other trams and have a bell cord on either side.
Yeah.
So you could probably string your bell cord through, see
where... Oh, so it comes through the centre and then...
Off to the sides and then into the middle again.
Yeah, true.
At the end of World War I, the Victorian government constituted a new semi-government instrumentality, the State Electricity Commission of Victoria. This was in line with the government's aim to provide electricity to all homes in the state and raise the standard of living in country areas. The SECV was to take over all privately owned power generating companies in Victoria and operate as a state-owned monopoly. The Electric Supply Company Victoria was one of the companies which the new state instrumentality was eager to acquire, but there were two problems. The company had been granted a 30-year franchise, not due to expire until the early 30s, and as well as supplying electricity power to Bendigo and surrounding municipalities, it owned and operated the tramway. There is evidence to suggest that the SECV was not particularly keen to accept responsibility for the tramway system, but it was to become an unavoidable part of the deal. Nor was the SECV originally vested with the power to operate a tramway, but this was changed by Act of Parliament, and under a special agreement in 1931, the SECV became the proprietor, albeit unwillingly, of tramway systems in Bendigo, Ballarat, and Geelong. In Bendigo, the Electric Supply Company of Victoria continued to operate the system under SECV supervision until the franchise expired in mid-1934. It was no prize which the SECV had acquired, and the Commission was quite aware of the problems it faced. The rolling stock and equipment were 30 years old, and the tracks were in poor repair. The Commission examined the feasibility of retaining the system or providing an alternative, but it finally decided that the tram should stay, at least in the short term. An immediate program of rehabilitation was put into action. Track reconstruction was the major project, with work on the overhead wiring and workshop equipment also being necessary. The estimated cost was over $60,000, but the SECV received considerable financial assistance from government grants and the National Recovery Fund. The work was completed efficiently and before the end of 1935. All overhead wiring had been renewed and more than 3 miles of new track laid. It is interesting to note, however, that despite the large outlay of public funds, the SECV had only planned the reconstruction of the system to last for 15 years. Before the takeover, the Electric Supply Company of Victoria had begun to replace and augment its dilapidated rolling stock. The company started a trend which was to continue for the life of the service and is responsible to a large degree for Bendigo's interesting collection of trams. Rather than strain its already overburdened finances by ordering new cars, the company looked around for second-hand ones. Over the years, it became a habit for other services to dispose of trams they no longer considered useful, fit for service or otherwise desirable, and so Bendigo became the repository for trams which may otherwise have ended up on the scrap heap. The first of these refugees were the open-ended California cars rejected by the Melbourne and Metropolitan Tramways Board as no longer serviceable due to their small size and therefore limited capacity. Already 14 new cars had arrived in Bendigo by 1936, and a number of these had been altered to allow for more economical one-man operation. The panel behind the driver was removed to allow the passengers to pay the motorman as they entered. Seats were rearranged and side panels were filled in. One of the trams, number 22, which arrived during this period, had been rejected in Melbourne because of its high steps and, for once, even the Bendigo passengers and operators, normally so acquiescent, objected and the tram was rarely in service. This period also saw the introduction of the now familiar cream and green SECV colours. Bendigo settled into its rejuvenated tram service with little difficulty. The improved equipment, updated rolling stock and better tracks meant a faster and more reliable service and fewer accidents and derailments. But the outbreak of World War II was to prove a testing time. Passenger numbers increased considerably and shortages in manpower and materials were to cause difficulties. The Government Ordnance Factory was built and the tram tracks were extended from Lake Waroona to North Bendigo to provide transport for the hundreds of workers it employed. Women were employed on the tramway for the first time, mainly as conductors, and despite the wartime problems, a continuous tram service was maintained. At this time, there was again a dispute between the tramway and the Victorian Railways. In order to complete the journey to the Ordnance Factory, the trams needed to cross the Swan Hill to Bendigo railway line, adjacent to the Chinese Joss House. The railways insisted on an overbridge which proved impossible to either finance or construct during the war, so that the tram line ended at the railway line. A short spur was built as a layover and the workers walked the remainder of the way. This wartime measure was to outlast the war, and the short spur became and still remains the permanent terminus at Emu Point. At the end of the war, Bendigo received an influx of large bogey tram cars, again because the MMTB had no further use for them. And in 1947, the famous Burnie cars started to arrive from Geelong. With the arrival of this extra rolling stock, the remaining original single truck cars in the Bendigo fleet were scrapped, including the two open crossbench summer cars known familiarly as toast racks, together with several of the Melbourne trams which had arrived in the early 1930s. One of the toast racks, number 18, was sold while the other, number 17, was converted for use as a track cleaning tram. Problems of safety seemed to dog the tramway from its earliest days. In the 1890s, the cabbies complained that the hissing steam trams with their clouds of smoke and sparks frightened the horses. In the early days of the electric trams, faulty tracks were the cause of derailments, and over the years, there were a number of nasty accidents between the trams and horse-drawn vehicles. With the increasing number of motor cars on the streets after World War II, the trams again became the target for criticism, and despite trams being restricted to the rails, they were constantly blamed for accidents. In the 50s, The SECV went to considerable effort and expense to provide safety devices for the trams, and in particular the rather inadequate exterior lighting was greatly improved. Indeed, by the end of the decade, the Bendigo trams were so festooned with lights and strips of reflective tape that they gave the city quite a festive appearance. Although the SECV chafed under the burden of constant losses incurred by the tramway, the system offered the travelling public a service which has never been duplicated. The trams provided regular, fast and reliable transport at frequent intervals for long hours, 7 days a week. Although not the most comfortable way to travel, it was certainly the cheapest. Some people thought the overhead cables cluttered the city skyline, but the electric power which ran the tram cars did not cause pollution problems, and the modern trams were quiet and smooth. The service offered by the tramway over the years was considerate and personal. Extra trams were always added to the normal run to cater for increased numbers on special occasions, such as race meetings, religious festivals, fairs, shows, and carnivals. Factories, businesses, and industry used the trams for their annual outings, and thousands of theatre and cinema goers were carried to and from performances. When the cinema first became popular, the trams played an important role. The same films were shown at the Bendigo and Eagle Hawk cinemas, with the first film at Bendigo showing second at Eagle Hawk, and vice versa. As each reel of film was finished at one cinema, it was sent by tram to the other. The trammy thus played a crucial part in the success of A Night at the Flicks. Special excursion tickets were printed and could be bought as part of a railway ticket from Melbourne to Bendigo, entitling the holder to travel on the Bendigo trams during the day's visit. There were tickets for visitors giving a whole day's travel throughout the city for as little as a shilling, and even parcel tickets. For threepence, a parcel would be carried by tram from the city to a designated tram stop or convenient shop along the route, where the conductor would hand it over at the shop or to the waiting recipient. It was not unusual for the conductor to deliver a parcel to the front door if it was close at hand. The conductors and drivers were a ready source of information. They pointed out places of interest, helped passengers find their destinations, and assisted the old and frail. They would hold the tram as a panting regular race to catch it, help a mother on board with pram and young children, and put up with late-night revellers who wanted to sing or spin yarns. During the years that the trams offered their inimitable service to the people of Bendigo, there were many characters amongst the drivers and conductors. There were some who sang, cracked jokes, teased the kids, and no doubt some grumpy ones too. But it is the helpful and personal service that most people remember, and what so many people miss today, and why the trams and their operators were so sadly mourned when the service finally came to an end on 16th April 1972. The population turned out in strength for an emotional farewell. In the days leading up to the closure, there were sentimental journeys by children and adults, both local and visitors from far afield. A group of 60 regulars from the Courthouse Hotel hired a tram for a pub crawl from the city to Eagle Hawk and back, armed with baskets of pies, pasties and sausage rolls, and to the strains of two piano accordions, the party stopped at all the pubs on the left on the way out, and on the right on the return journey. Less alcoholic, but no less uproarious, were the trips taken by enthusiastic school children and their teachers. An elderly lady, Mrs. W. Peak of Epsom, who had travelled on one of the first electric trams in Bendigo when she was a pupil at Gravel Hill Primary School in 1903, went for her last trip 69 years later, on the Sunday the tram stopped. That day, 8 of the trams were out on the tracks, and they were followed back to the depot by a hooting motorcade. Bands played, "Now is the hour when we must say goodbye," and there were tears in the eyes of many of the onlookers. At 6 p.m. on Sunday, 16th April 1972, the last tram turned off Macrae Street to the tune of "Will Ye No Come Back Again," played by Pipe Major Neil Innes of the Bendigo Highland Pipe Band, and by 6:20 p.m. all were back in the depot. The SECV era was over, but the era of the Bendigo tramways under the auspices of the Bendigo Trust was already underway.